If you can, open up your Bibles to the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3. We're starting a new series called Now What? And the reason why is because it's a question people had after Easter. Now what? What's next? And we're going to break this open for the next few weeks. Believe you're going to be blessed. You already are in the devotional called Now What? And now we're going to break bread. I want to welcome all of you that are watching online. God bless you. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 11. I got to take my glasses off because I'm 42 and I'm getting blind. Yet God has made everything beautiful for its own time. He planted eternity in the human heart, but even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to the end. I want to talk to you today about 3 days and now what? And here's the goal today. At the end of the service, we're going to break the spirit of failure over people's lives today. In Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for the spirit of revelation. Give our minds illumination that we would experience transformation. God, I pray, give us a mind to perceive and a heart to receive all that you have. And I ask that after this message, we'll never be the same. In Jesus' name, and all God's people say, amen, amen. Well, if you don't have a message outline, our ushers will be more than happy to get you one. All of you that are in small groups, we want to release you right now and go get your training in Jesus' name. We are kicking off a new series called Now What? And what we learned that Easter and at Easter is that everybody comes to Easter services. Everybody. Doesn't matter if you haven't been in church in 20 years, folks come to Easter services. The question is why don't people come back? You see, the thing is that you can ask anybody, what did God do for you? Everyone tell you, God died for my sin. Yeah, he died. Okay, we know that. But most people don't even know why he died. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21, it says, this is the kind of life you've been invited into. Now, I want to park there for a second because here's what's important. Is that every one of us has either thrown parties or we've gone to a party. And when you throw a party or you plan a wedding, you send out all the invitations. And you send out the invitations, but what you're really doing is you're preparing for everybody to come. See, when an invitation goes out, you're really preparing for everybody to come. No one sends an invitation to a party, and then when people come, no one knows what the party's all about. Why? Because you prepared for it. So when Jesus said, I've invited you into this life, here's what you got to realize. He would never send you an invitation to this life if he has not prepared for it. So he's prepared everything for your life. There's nothing you'll ever go through that God hasn't prepared. And the reason why is because he invited you into it. He said, this is the life that I have for you. And watch, he says, the kind of life Christ lived. He suffered everything that came his way, excuse me, so you would know that it could be done. And he also knows how to do it, step by step. Everything about God is about taking steps. Nothing just happens overnight. Your change doesn't happen overnight. Your family doesn't change overnight. Your marriage won't change overnight. But I'll tell you how it will. Step by step. You continue to make those steps, and God will begin the change in your life. You know, when you talk to people, you'll sit there and say, hey, man, why did Jesus die for your life? And people will go, oh, well, you know, he died so that we could be free from sin. But it goes further than that. The reason why Jesus died for your life was not only to eradicate sin, but primarily is that you'll get to know God, that you'll have this relationship with him, like this, like you will know who God is. You know, back in the Bible days, if you sinned, you had to go to a priest, and then the priest would take your sins before the Lord. The Catholics still practice that today. You got to go to confession, go in a box, open it up, And then you got to confess to the priest, and then the priest will pray to the Father. But how many know you can go to the Father yourself? Why? Because you know what? Because you have a relationship with him. You can know God, okay? He died for you so that you would know him. But he also died for you so that you would find freedom. See, everybody needs freedom in their life. We're all bound by certain things. But the more I get to know God, watch this, the more freedom I experience from God. It's like everybody wants to be free without ever getting to know God. But the more I come to church on Sundays, like you're here today, the more I come to church on Wednesdays, the more I get to know God, the more free I'll become. I can't tell you when I stopped drinking. I can just tell you that I had an ambition to know God. I couldn't tell you the day I stopped cursing. I don't know when that day happened. It just stopped. Because the more I got to know God, the more freedom it took place in my life. And so the more I get to know him, the more I have freedom. And see, God died for that. But see, he died to eradicate sin. The word sin comes from an archery term, which means miss the mark. And so just like a bullseye, when we have lived our life, we've sinned so much that we've just missed the mark. And so when you walk around life knowing you've missed the mark, I've missed the mark in relationships. I've missed the mark in parenting. I've missed the mark in my career. I've missed all these marks in my life. Here's what you live with. You know that Jesus has forgiven you of your sin, but do you want to know what you continue to live with? The fact that you failed. And so what's holding you back is not the sin in your life, because you know God has forgiven you of that. What holds you back is the fact that you failed. And you know Jesus forgave you, but here's the real struggle. Have I forgiven myself? And so Christians today are not free, not because they're in sin. They're not free because they feel like failures. And so Jesus died not only to, watch this, eradicate sin. Because you know what he did with that bullseye as they put it up? You know what he did with it when he forgave you of your sin? Here's what Jesus did. Put that bullseye. He took all those arrows away. They can't even be found. It's why he removes our transgressions from us. They cannot be found. He remembers not our sin no more. Listen, he remembers not that we've missed the mark. Here's the amazing. God has the ability to forget your sins, but we struggle to continue to remember them. And this is why we live in failure. And see, the thing is that we know this is why Jesus died. So you can ask all kinds of people, why did Jesus die? That's why everyone comes on Easter, because Jesus died. I come on Easter because Jesus died for me. That's why everybody wears a cross around their neck. Jesus died for me. With Jesus dying. I thought, man, it'd be great. Someone start a new pendant. How about an open grave? Empty. What about if we were wearing open grave, empty? He ain't on a cross no more. He ain't even in the tomb no more. Oh, yeah, Jesus died for me. Why did Jesus die for you? He died for me to save my sin. But why don't people come back? You want to know why? Because people honestly don't know why he resurrected. I can ask all kinds of people, why did Jesus die for you? Oh, he died for me to save my sin. Why did he resurrect? I'm going to tell you why he resurrected. He resurrected, number one, so that you could discover your purpose. This is why more people are living today, but don't even know why they're alive. The greatest danger is dying when you don't even know why you were born. Like, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I've not discovered my purpose. And so Jesus resurrected, because when Jesus resurrected, watch this, he could have went to the synagogue, scolded all the Pharisees, you know, the ones that plotted to kill him. He could have went there and said, hey, y'all, how you like me now? Look at me. I'm alive. I told you guys couldn't keep me down. But he didn't choose to do that. You know who he went back to? The disciples. In the Bible, when something is first mentioned at the same time, in Bible calls, they call it the law of first mention, which means it's God's original intent. So God's original intent was not to resurrect, to go to the temple, to prove to the Sadducees that he's Christ. Jesus went back to the disciples who were hiding because he came and he told them the reason why I resurrected was to reinstate your purpose so that you'll discover your purpose and you'll make a difference. You want to know why Jesus has come back into your life? Not just to save you from your sin. He did that 2,000 years ago. You want to know why he came back into your life? Because he wants to remind you, all these times you've missed the mark, it still hasn't changed my mind, the purpose and the plan that I have for your life. I have not wavered from that. I decided while you were in your mother's womb, this was going to be your purpose. This was it. Well, Pastor Obey, you don't realize I messed up all kinds of stuff. No. You stop disqualifying yourself. Because God has not disqualified you. And the problem is the reason why we're not coming to church faithfully is because, listen, we're carrying failure and we don't understand why would God still want to use me. Here's why. Here's why he does. It's because he resurrected. He could have stayed in the tomb. Everything would have been finished. We would have been saved from our sin. You and I could just live a good life, but we'd have never known how to discover our purpose and make a difference. That's why he resurrected. So you sit there and say, well, Pastor Obed, why did it take 3 days? I mean, what was those 3 days all about? I'm going to show you something that's going to change your life. I'm going to get my guys up here real quick. Because here it is. We all know that Jesus died on Friday. Okay, Jesus died on Friday. We all know that. It was the day of wearing. And watch this. When Jesus died on Friday, here's what happened. Jesus died on Friday. Watch this. Jesus died on Friday so that sin could be eradicated. But the expression that you still carry by your sin is being a failure. Failed marriage, failed relationships. And guess what? He says, this is what I died for. I died on Friday to break the spirit of failure over your life. But what were the disciples doing on Saturday? They were hiding. I'm going to show it to you. They were hiding because they were doubting. And so these disciples on Saturday, we're surviving. And then on Sunday, we all know that Jesus resurrected, right? Because he resurrected so that your life will be thriving. Here's my question to you. Is your life thriving? Is your marriage thriving? Your family thriving? Is it thriving? Because if it's not, then you got to ask yourself, why is it that I'm not living in Sunday? Maybe it is that you're still trapped on Friday. Because you can't get to Sunday unless you overcome Friday. And so this is why the devil keeps on throwing failure at you. You're a failed parent. You're a failed this. You're a failed that. Because the devil wants to keep you on Friday. He doesn't want you to get to Sunday, because when you get to Sunday, you're thriving, you're making a difference, you're fulfilling your purpose, and the devil can throw all kinds of stuff at you, and you're like, baby, I'm not no failure no more. Failing is an action. Failure is a mentality. And so you're still feeling like a failure because of something that went on in your past, and it's keeping you on Friday. And then there's some people that go, oh, well, Pastor Obed, you know, I've kind of got a little over my favor. Then why are you surviving? Because if your life is just surviving, then that means you got some doubts. And you're hiding, because that's what the apostles did. They were hiding. Well, Pastor Obed, how could you say I'm hiding? Are you serving? Are you making a difference in the lives of people? Come on, have you discovered your purpose? Come on, are you investing in people's lives? Because that's what a thriver does. A thriver says, I'm going to give to you what's been given to me. I'm going to take you those steps. See, let me do this. Let's take this whole auditorium, and those of you watching online, let's take this whole auditorium, Let's go from a church. Let's make it a living room right now. Let's make it my living room. Because I'm going to tell you my Fridays. I'm going to tell you the first time I ever felt like a failure was when my dad, who raised me to be a football player, I was 120 pounds, football player. And my dad sent me to all these camps to play football. I remember Barry Switzer in my house, my mom making dinner for Barry Switzer, the coach of the Oklahoma Sooners, because he was recruiting Jamel Holloway, who was my dad's quarterback. I remember Terry Donahue from that other school that I can't mention on my platform, or it'll poison it, right? Coming in and trying to recruit some of the players that my dad was. I remember John Robinson at that time was a coach of USC walking into my house, my mom cooking him dinner because he was recruiting some of my dad's players. My dad was like, Obed, you're going to go. You're going to go to college. You're going to be a football player. And so I was raised to be a quarterback. My dad was an offensive coordinator. 10 years, they won championships in a row, state championship. When I was in the 10th grade, we were number 2 in the nation. And I was playing JV for 2 games. And then they moved me up to varsity. On the 3rd game, the last play, our starting quarterback tears ligaments in his knee. So my dad, on the bus ride home, back to the school, says, are you ready to start next week? I'm like, what? He goes, are you ready to start next week? I'm like, are you serious? He's like, yeah, you were born for this. And so, you know, I got ready all week. We won. We won the next game. And let me tell you something. I was in 10th grade, come on, varsity quarterback with no girlfriend. So you already know what happened. I mean, I was like, come on, all the girls coming, right? And I wasn't prepared for it. So guess what I started doing? Ditching classes, messing up. And then the playoffs came and grades came out and I became ineligible because I failed Spanish. Spanish. It's not like I didn't fail math. I failed Spanish. I know no Spanish. Yo quiero Taco Bell. You know what I mean? So I never forget walking in the locker room. My dad was leaning up against the wall like this. And he looked at me. He says, how could you do this to me? It haunted me for years. That moment right there placed that tag on my life. From that moment on, I dropped out of school. Got heavily hooked on drugs. Alcohol. I didn't care about my life. You want to know why I didn't care about my life? Because I felt like a failure. I could tell you the second time I felt like a failure is after I got saved. I got saved on July 8th, 1989. The Lord told me, don't date no one for 2 years. I'm like, Lord, that's the devil talking. He says, no. Don't date no one for 2 years because you so messed up. The next person I bring in your life is going to be your wife. I'm like, wow. So I didn't date no one for 2 years. And then all of a sudden, he brought this cute blonde in my life. She was perfect. And I don't say that her life was together. Never drank, never did nothing. I mean, she was whole. Loved the Lord and prayer, you know, all the time. I mean, she loved God. And her dad would open up the door for her. Like, opens up the door for his mom, her mom. Then he'd open up the door for her. And then, like, she'd come home and she'd just take her shoes off and her dad would get up from the couch, grab lotion, begin to rub her feet. I'm like, man. So I decided to break up with her. She goes, why are we breaking up? I said, I don't know. We're just breaking up. And I didn't know why I broke up with her until I realized one day I felt like a failure. I felt like I couldn't amount up to that because I never saw that. I never experienced that. So I disguised it in pride. I lied about it because of my ego. But when it was, when I was all alone and nobody was around, here was the reason why I broke up with her. Because of that. I didn't feel good about myself. So how could I feel good about her? Let me tell you the third time when I felt like a failure. Was 6 years ago when this church was going through all kinds of stuff. I couldn't say anything. And there were times I'd drive to church crying, saying, God, I don't even want to preach. Why would you even want me to preach? You got to raise someone else up. Maybe I was the one to start the church, but I'm not the one to continue it. You don't even realize how powerful failure would drive your life, even when you're so in love with God. And it will cause you to start questioning your love for God when it has nothing to do with your love for God. It just has everything to do with the fact that that thing needs to be broken over your life. And so I had to realize, Obed, you're not a failure. You have failed, but you're not a failure. And so I had to decide to move on. Same way you do. See, think of the disciples. Thank you, guys. Think of the disciples. Think about these guys that, like, when there was two fish and five loaves, and they saw Jesus take them, and they fed the multitudes, and they're like, whoa. Think about when they came to Lazarus' tomb, and they're like, well, you're 4 days late. Jesus says, send me to the tomb. Sends him to the tomb. He calls Lazarus out. Then he tells the disciples, no, you go undress him so you get a close look on how I did this miracle and how it came to pass. Think about the disciples that saw Jesus walk on water. What about when they all thought they were going to die? They wake Jesus up in the boat and they tell him, Lord, we're going to die. And he speaks to the wind. And they're so amazed that the wind stopped, they said, even the winds obey him. How is it that these men, listen to me, how is it that these men had a high definition picture of what Jesus did, and yet when the time came for the rubber to hit the road, they still felt like failures? How would you feel if your last conversation you had with Jesus was, hey, I just want to let you know you're going to deny me 3 times, and then you do, and then you have no way to go back to Jesus because he already died? How would you feel? Can I take you to that story? John chapter 21. Look what it says. Later, Jesus appeared again to the disciples by the Sea of Galilee. I want to stop there. Later, Jesus appeared again to the disciples besides the Sea of Galilee. Listen, they had already walked with Jesus for 3.5 years. They saw all the miracles they did. Now watch this. The Sea of Galilee was the same place Jesus called Peter, James, and John. So in Matthew chapter 4, these fishermen are out there fishing. They got nothing in their net. Jesus sees them. He says, drop your nets and follow me. They're like, okay, we got nothing to lose because we got no fish. So they drop their nets. They follow Jesus. They see all these miracles. And 3.5 years later, guess where they're at? The Sea of Galilee. Guess what they have in their nets? Nothing. Here's a principle for you to realize. Every time you return back to the place God called you out of, you'll always end up empty. Empty. Pastor Obed, I struggle with church. Well, what do you want to do? Well, you know, I just can't. I keep on going back. Girl, you're going to be empty. Because the only thing the world can promise you is emptiness. That's it. Your nets will never be full. And so listen, he calls them in Matthew 4, their nets are empty. They see all the miracles, and in John 21, when they were so filled with shame and failure, guess what they did? Hey guys, let's go fishing. So the disciples were there, Simon Peter, nicknamed the twin Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples. And look what they decide. Simon Peter said, I'm going fishing. Peter hasn't gone fishing for 3.5 years. But once failure came upon him, he decided to go back to what his old life was all about. Come on, talk to me, somebody. And look what it says. We'll come too, they all said, since we have nothing too. So they went out in the boat, but they caught nothing all night. Isn't it amazing that we party at night? Okay, ain't no one party in the day. They party at night. And when you party at night, you go back to the party at night, you still catch nothing. And at dawn, Jesus was standing on the beach, but the disciples couldn't see who was. He called out, fellas, have you caught anything fish? They said, oh, no, Lord, we haven't caught nothing, man. And then it goes on to say this, watch this. Then he said, throw out your net on the right side of the boat and you'll get some. So they did, and they couldn't haul in the net because there was so many fish in it. Then the disciple Jesus loved said to Peter, he says, no, no. And now all of a sudden, this is the first time Peter is having a conversation with Jesus after he denied him. And look what he tells Peter. He says, it's the Lord. He didn't say, hey, it's Jesus. No, because he already fulfilled that. He says, it's the Lord. Because I was Jesus to you when you walked with me. I'll be your Lord when I leave you again. It's the Lord. Look what he said. Watch this. Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord. So he put on his tunic. He jumped in the water. He headed to the shore. The others stayed in the boat and pulled the loaded net into the shore, for they were only about 100 yards from the shore. And when they got there, they found breakfast waiting for them. Fish cooking over some fire and some bread. Bring some of the fish you've just caught, Jesus said. So watch this. So Simon Peter went aboard and dragged the net to the shore. There were 153 large fish, and yet the net hadn't torn. Why did Jesus come back? Why did Jesus come back to you? Why did Jesus come back to me? Why did Jesus come back to the disciples? Here's why. This is why he did. This is why he added John 21 in, because John 20 ended everything. But he had to let John 21 get there because he wanted you to know something. And the first thing he wanted you to know was that he wanted to show you the power of restoration. He wanted to show you the power of restoration, because here's the God we serve. God is all about restoring your life. He's all about that. It's what he wants to do. God wants to restore lives. Listen, God is in the business of turning mistakes into miracles. God is in the business of taking brokenness and turning into blessedness. That's what God is into. And so the thing is that he said, Peter, you failed me, but that's not going to be the last conversation me and you are going to have. I'm going to come back to you. He could have went anywhere else, but he went to reinstate the ones he had called. The second reason why Jesus came back to you, listen, here's why he came. He wanted to show us that he who calls never gives up on them. Look what the Bible says. Here's what the Bible says about this. The Bible says this. It says, God's gift and God's call. How many are called of God? How many, God called your name? Come on, if you're saved, God called your name. Now, I want you to get this. Here, this is for you. God's gifts and God's call are under a full warranty. Which means this, anything that's under a full warranty means if it's broken, you don't gotta pay for it. Why don't you gotta pay for it? Because it's already been paid for. Let me tell you something. Well, Pastor Obed, you don't realize I'm going through all this because I'm paying the price for it. Girl, you ain't Jesus. No. It's been paid for already because you're under a full warranty. Stop punishing yourself. And the third thing he did is he wanted to show us that everything you are will be, and you will be, is in him. So everything you are, everything you will be, it's in him. Look what the Bible says. The Bible says this. It says, it's in Christ that we find out who we are and what we're living for. Long before we first heard of Christ and got our hopes up, he had his eyes on us. We took our eyes off of him, but he had his eyes on us. Here's why he came back. Here's why he returned. to show you that your life can be restored. To remind you, he hasn't changed his mind for what he created you to be. And he came back so that you will know, as you've tried other things, you'll never be fulfilled unless it's in him. So here's what he wants to do. Really quick, I'm going to come to a close. Here's what he wants to do. Number one, here's what he wants to do. He wants to break the spirit of failure over your life. It's what God wants to do today. He wants to break the spirit of failure over your life. Failure will drive you away from God. Freedom draws you towards God. It's what he wants to do. Here's what the Bible says. Bible says this in John 21. Look what it said. So they went out in the boat, but they caught nothing all night. When failure is over, when failure is broken over your life, there'll never be a day where you're empty. As long as failure is over your life, you'll always live days where you're empty. You'll feel like, man, I'm just empty. Man, I don't feel fulfilled, Pastor. Man, I just feel like I've blown it. No, no, no. Friends, can I tell you something? Here's the purpose of failure. The purpose of failure is this. It wants to remind you that you've blown it so that you continue to blow it. It's one thing to know I've blown it, but that's been forgiven. So I don't need to live another day thinking I blew it. Come on, are you hearing me? I don't need to punish myself. I don't need to be hard on myself. I don't need to do that because Jesus has already taken all the arrows and all the missed marks that I did. They're no longer there anymore. Come on, you receive that? The second thing God wants to do is God wants your life to thrive and not just survive. He doesn't want you to live day to day surviving. Oh, I'm just barely making it. Praise God, I'm just making it. No, man, what you talking about? I'm praising God because I just made it. I was speaking to 100 pastors on Friday, and they were all from large African American Episcopalian Pentecostal Methodist blah blah. You know, they have these long names, right? And they were all there. All had their collars on. I mean, they were suited from the head to toe. And so I asked them, I said, you know, how do you want me to dress? And they said, oh, well, you know, you just come as you are. And I was a keynote speaker to all these pastors, right? So usually I wear a blazer when I speak. You know, I think you should wear it. But I decided I'm not going to. So I wore some ripped jeans, a hoodie on. I had a beanie on. And I had some Yeezys, Doc, right? So I walk in, and, you know, everyone's looking like, who is that? And then when they announce the speaker, I walk up there. And they're all looking at me funny, man. It's so hilarious. And, like, I'm Pastor Mike was with me, right? And Pastor Mike goes, I didn't know you was going to wear ripped jeans. I go, oh, yeah, yeah, it's part of my illustration today. And I got up there. And I said, yeah, you're probably all looking at me because I got ripped jeans on, wearing a hoodie with the beanie. You've already decided you're not going to listen to me just by the way I look. And this is why the only people that listen to you are the people that look like you. Pastor Mike, is that how I started? Well, I got their attention. There. I said, you know what? I said, why are you guys still preaching Egypt? Why are you still preaching? We're going to get out of this. Praise God. Hallelujah. We're coming out. And everyone shouts that we're coming out, but you never take time to teach them what they're coming into. Because I never heard them shout what they're coming into. I only heard them shout what they're coming out of. How many times do you have to come out of something? I tell my church, don't shout because you're coming out of something. Shout because you're coming into something. And they're looking at me like, I said, listen, you want to know why churches are emptying? It's simple. I want to be empowered to come into something. not just be delivered coming out of something. We could preach deliverance all the time, but what about empowerment? What about me feeling that, man, I'm victorious now? Man, my shout is a shout of victory, not a victim no more. That's why Jesus returned back to them. Break that victim spirit off of you, Peter. Break that spirit of failure off of you, Peter. It's not who you are. That's why I came to you. And then lastly, as I end, number three, here it is. Watch this. God wants to guide your step, your life, step by step. It's all he wants. He just says, come on, take another step. It's all God wants to do in your life because it's what he's interested in. He's interested in you taking another step. That's all he wants. A step towards restoration. A step towards victory. A step towards being whole. Hey, you can continue to live your life where it is if you just continue to stay still. But what about taking a step? That's what we're about here. It's simple. By the time I was done speaking to all these pastors, I had them all saying, we're a church of steps. I said, I promise you, if you continue to lead your people in the right steps, they'll get to their destination. And that's what we're about here. It's a moment right now because I want you to see what happened to Peter's life. Here's what happened to Peter's life. He was wearing the spirit of failure. Jesus comes back and returns back to him. And when he finds out it's Jesus, you know the first thing he does? He puts on a tunic, which means he clothes himself with a garment he had not worn since he denied Christ. You know what that means? Salvation. Peter got saved again. Can I tell you the next thing Peter did? Was that the Bible says he jumped into the water. It's the picture of baptism. And then can I tell you the third thing that Peter did? Peter got the fish and brought him to Jesus. It represents bringing people to Jesus. So Peter, in one moment, got saved, showed us the picture of being saved, showed us the picture of being baptized, showed us the picture of bringing people to Jesus. You know what those are called? Steps. Where are you at in your step? And how can we help you get to your next? Because I'm going to tell you what I'm committed to. I'm committed to you taking your next step. I can tell you what our pastors are committed to. We're committed in you taking your next step. Every one of us will be in different steps. And when you walked in today, in your worship guide, there was a response card. I want you to pull that out for just a minute because this is what it is. Many have filled it out. Because faith without a response is dead. You could just hear the word, but you got to do it. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do. It's a private moment. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to ask yourself, where am I? Listen, if you already know God, if you sit there and say, Pastor Obed, I want to know God more. That's what I want. I want to know God more. I want you to check off A. I want you to check it off. Say, that's what I want. That's my next step. I want to know God more. But maybe you're here tonight and you say, Pastor Obed, I already know God. But I don't know my purpose. I want you to check off B. I want to know what my purpose is. But maybe you're here tonight and you say, Pastor Obed, I know God. I know my purpose. But you're not living in freedom. I want you to check off C. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor Obed, I know God. I know my purpose. I'm living in freedom, but I'm not making a difference. I want you to check off D. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to follow up with you. and we're going to help you take your next step. Can I tell you why where I'm at today, even as a pastor? It's because I've had people help me take my next step. You want to know why Lissette and I got some confidence of running multiple campuses? It's because we're around people who are helping us take next steps. Because I had to respond. I had to be real with myself. Can we really do this? Can I do this? See, friends, you can't get to your next step without somebody helping you get there. Don't think you're going to get there on your own. It's a moment today. Because we're all going to respond. We're going to get back. Now, here's what I'm going to do before Pastor comes up and gives you instruction. Here's what I'm going to do. We're going to break the spirit of failure over your life. From this moment on, you'll never live a day in failure again. When God sets you free, listen, when God sets you free and the devil tries to remind you, oh, well, you're a failure. No, God set me free on April 10th, 6 o'clock service. I'm already free. Well, look at your children. They're still messed up. No, I've been set free. I don't have to feel like a failure. Well, look at your life. Nope, I don't have to. I don't accept that because I'm not a failure. He's broken that over my life. Father, I thank you today for every person in this place that feels they've been held back on Friday and not living in Sunday because they felt like failures. Lord, like myself, you had to break it over my life. And I believe today, right now, Holy Spirit, you are breaking it over the lives of these people. You're breaking it over the people that are watching online right now. Lord, I believe today that we are breaking the spirit of failure in this church. That we will no longer live for Fridays. We will live for Sundays. That God, we're thriving. We're not just surviving, but we're thriving. Our marriage, our relationship, our family, our children, our house, our career, everything we are, God, we are going to thrive in Jesus' name. We're never going to let our past hold us back. We're never going to let the times that we missed the mark hold us back. We're never going to let dysfunction in our past hold us back. Lord, we break it in the name of Jesus tonight. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we break every mistake. We break every shame, every bit of guilt, every bit of anger, every bit of action. And Lord, even when we walk around and we go, I blew it. No, we break that right now, God. And in Jesus' name, whom the Son sets free is free indeed right now. And Lord, I thank you that we're free. We're being set free right now. God, I thank you that the Holy Spirit is setting my mind free, setting my spirit free, setting my heart free, setting my emotions free right now, God. No longer am I a failure in Jesus' name. We're whole in you, God. We believe today. We believe today. We will never live another day. And devil, we remind you, you can never bring a dart back to me again. In Jesus' name, my life will never, never be in failure again. Come on, if you believe that and receive that, give the Lord a big clap offering. Like you know, he's broken failure off of you.